There's several listed in the bulletin, and more information that I'll provide for you, but do take a look at those that are listed there as well. Want to remember, let's see, Margaret Hyde, she did have her surgery. She is recuperating from that. She had it on her back, and so she's at home recuperating from that, so we want to remember her. And Holly is suffering from a staph infection after her surgery. She did have the surgery, but the staph infection is making it worse for her. And, she's having difficulty recuperating from that, so we want to remember her in our prayers as well. Dad's surgery went well Saturday, so Saturday, I don't know where that came from, last Tuesday, so that's, he's doing well, and just take a little bit of time to recuperate from that. So these and others we want to continue to remember in our prayers as well, as we are reminded of the brief time that we have on this earth, and the frailty that we experience, and we all go through these things, but let's support one another as we can, while we can. Also want to remember those that we've encouraged us to remember our leadership, pray for them, pray for those that supporting in other countries, as well as those that we know of that are being persecuted, and praying for ourselves too, that we might be able to continue to lead a quiet life. We are truly blessed in a lot of ways, and let's remember to give God thanks for all of the blessings that we have. I also want to remind everyone of opportunities that we have to assemble here, that we have our Bible studies every Sunday morning, 9 o'clock, great study for all ages. We've had a very good study in the adult class through Job, and that's been a good study for all of us. We will meet again this afternoon at 5 o'clock, and then, of course, Wednesday night at 7 o'clock for our Bible study. So encourage everyone to take advantage of all the opportunities that we have to assemble together here. And even as the writer to the Hebrews said, you know, this is an opportunity that we can stir one another up to love and good works. So let's take advantage of all these opportunities that we have. In our singing this morning, our first song will be number 19 in the songbook. Probably noticed in the bulletin the continuing in the series of lessons that Gary has for us concerning unity, and this one of course is on the unity of one hope, things that unite us, and a reminder truly of the blessings that we have in the letter refer to as 1 Peter. He said, you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And also, as Peter was proclaiming to the Sanhedrin in Acts chapter 4, he said, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. We recognize the uniqueness of the gift that God gave us in his Son. And it is the only sacrifice that he has given whereby we might be reconciled to God. And so even as Jesus told his disciples earlier, as they were partaking of the Lord's Supper together, the Passover together, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. There's no other way. And so truly there is great power in the name of in Jesus' name, and that all the blessings that all the spiritual blessings that we enjoy are only in him.
When we gather together and think of all the things we need, the biggest thing we need, of course, is to know about Christ and what he done for us. And when we give of our means, this helps us to spread his word. So we need to know that when we give in such a light that we're recognizing that the world needs Christ. So when we give today, we give to better ourselves, to better others, to help the children of this congregation, to help in our studies, and to help us to realize that no one has outgiven Christ and ever can. Christ gave his life that we may live. And we need to remember that when we give, we help others to live because we further the cause of Christ.
Let's pray.
The Heavenly Father, the things we bring back together so we can sing praise to thy name and worship you, Lord. Bless this offering as we give portion of our own in the back that belongs to you anyhow, Lord, that this is used to further your kingdom, Lord, and
spread the word. And just bless us, forgive all our sins. Heaven and we pray. Amen.
Psalm number 773, Miss Springhold. In the letter to the Hebrews, it's recorded for us, so when God desired to show more convincingly to the heirs of the promise the unchangeable character of his purpose, he guaranteed it with an oath, so that by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled for refuge might have strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope set before us. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. The writer here encourages us that we have this sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, hope that enters into the place behind the curtain, as it were, in the most holy place. The psalm expresses this as a whispering hope, but it is a hope that we have with us at all times, a reminder of the promises that we've been given.
Soft as the voice of an angel, breathing a lesson I've heard. Hope with a gentle persuasion, whispers a comforting word. Wait till the darkness is over. Wait till the temple.
our prayer.
Let us pray. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we come humbly to your presence, and as you said, come boldly. We come boldly this morning, thanking you for the gift of your Son, the gift of the written word, the gospel we follow. We thank you for the gathering here, the family. We thank you for Gary and all those that preach and teach. We thank you for our elders and our leadership, the deacons that serve. Heavenly Father, help us all realize that we must serve as they do, to better to help them and to better direct this whole family. Heavenly Father, this morning with our call for unity and hope, Heavenly Father, help us to realize that we as individuals are sons and daughters of you. And as we gather together as individuals at this, we're our family. We are your family, whether we're here together or whether we are apart. Heavenly Father, help us to realize that when we do come together on this time to worship you, not to be entertained, to worship you, Heavenly Father, help us to realize how all others that may, in some names, meet in your name, seem to excuse or welcome those and all the sins. We must realize that each and every one of us have shortcomings. Each one of us still have sins at work in our lives. Sometimes we must realize that sometimes even the smallest is equal to the greatest. Heavenly Father, help us to realize that when we walk in here, this is our sanctuary. This is our safe place. This is the place that we come together as one. That we pray together, we study together, and we support each other, realizing that we lay our sins and our shortcomings down before you, and we meet and praise you, and use this time to gather ourselves as we part from today, and we go out into the world where we truly show our Christianity. Heavenly Father, help this family to remain strong. Help this family to remain the scriptural base that you want us to be. Heavenly Father, we thank you for everything that we have. We thank you for the opportunities to be able to help others. Heavenly Father, we pray that as each one of us go, that we realize that when we're ridiculed and we're made fun of and we're challenged, let us realize that shows us that we're right. Heavenly Father, in everything this morning we do, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Before we take the Lord's Supper together, we'll sing the 514 on the cross of Calvary. We'll sing the first, second, and fourth stanzas, and then the chorus at the end. In Paul's letter that he wrote to Titus, we have for our education the statement that he recorded. He said, "For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and the renewal of the Holy Spirit, from whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of an eternal life." It wasn't possible for us to be reconciled to God except because of the sacrifice that he provided for himself for us. And this sacrifice, we remember that Jesus gave for us as we partake of the cup and the fruit of the vine and the bread each first day of the week. remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, and we examine ourselves to see our relationship to the body. So as we sing the words of this song and reflecting upon the cross, upon the sacrifice Jesus made for us, thinking about the life that we're living, are we living it as we should be in Christ?
On the cross of Calvary, Jesus died for thee and me. There he shed his precious blood, that from sin we might be free. Oh, the cleansing stream doth flow, and it washes white as snow. It was
Steve mentioned this morning how unique the cross is. And we think about today and where we're at, there is a uniqueness that nothing can compare. And when we think about people worldwide being in the church and partaking of this uniqueness of the cross, it offers the world an opportunity to remember the most precious life that was given upon that cruel cross. When we think about today, it was set aside by the Lord so that we can remember the most important event of all time. There's nothing more important on this day that can occupy our time than to remember Christ who saved us, Christ who hung upon that cruel cross. There could have been hundreds of thousands or millions of people possibly that died upon the cross, but not the cross that Jesus died upon. It was a unique cross. It was a cross that bared the burdens of the world, the sins of the world. There's no single cross in the world that we can look upon that is so special as the cross that Jesus hung upon. It's not the wood that made it special. It's not the shape of it. It's not that it was standing in the ground, but it's the fact that the Son of God was hanging upon that cross. and the Son of God saved us. When we partake of the bread, we remember his body upon this day. That's why this day is so special. And we are to continue to remember him each and every day. And what better way than to start off by remembering Christ as he hung upon the cross. Would you pray for us?
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the bread of the Son's body that was beaten and put on the cruel cross for remission of our sins. For those who take this bread, do it to please the mind of thee. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You know, when we think of blood, you know, we think of the redness of it, how it gives life to our body. But there's no blood like the blood of Christ. The uniqueness of that blood to cleanse us of our sins, to take away the sins of the world. What a uniqueness. What a blood that come from God. It allowed us to be who we are. Worldwide, there's Christians everywhere that's partaking of this blood because it means so much to each and every one of us. On this day, do we remember that? Do we know that? We're so special in the sight of God. We're his creation. He loved us so much. The uniqueness of that blood shows love. It shows how much God cared for us. And we need to remember that each and every day because there's nothing more important than the blood of Christ.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this cup of your Son's blood that was shed on the cross for the remission of our sins. That those who take this cup and do it and please the mind of thee. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
song to be 438. My hope is built on nothing less. That's the first part of the first stanza. It says, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness, his righteousness. And continuing in our thinking of the sacrifice Jesus made for us, we're reminded of Jesus' blood and how it is that we have the promises of God and how it is that we have the hope that has been provided to us through him. As we sing the words of this song together, we're reminded of things that Paul wrote, especially to the Corinthians. He said, and because of him, speaking of God, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption. And according to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he builds upon it, for no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Jesus is our true foundation and our true hope. And as we sing the words of this song together, encouraging ourselves and one another as we proclaim the hope that we have in Christ. If it's convenient for you, would you stand with me while we sing together?
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness
number 67, if you are marked out in our psalm books, number 67.
You can mark your book, and I'll mark the screen for you, whichever way you like to do that. We are continuing our lesson series on things that unite, and if you want to go ahead and look at Ephesians chapter 4, the first six verses, we are back there. I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There's one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. So again, this letter of encouragement, these verses of encouragement, Paul is urging, of course, the church in Ephesus and also us and anybody else that's reading this and in the future to be eager, verse number 3, to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. And again, this is something that if this idea of being eager to do something we want to do. So, okay, well, what do we need to do? And so he lays out these ones that we need to focus on, these seven ones to put our attention on, to focus on, to make sure that as a family of God, we are making sure that we are maintaining that connection with each other, this unity with each other, but also, just like Jesus prayed, unity with Him, unity with the Father, so that we can all be one. And of course, the ultimate goal, all be one together in heaven for all eternity. So the hope today that we're going to talk about, I'm sorry, the one today we're going to talk about is hope. And we've talked about the body and the spirit. And so here's the question, excuse me, what is it about hope that helps us maintain biblical unity? And so that's the topic we're going to look at, this idea of hope, being able to answer the question. But before we do, it's just a reminder. We've talked about this before when we talk about God and this hope that He provides us and the scriptures and the hope that we read about. It's not the same thing about, my granddaughter Kaylee had a birthday party yesterday, and she had a list of things that she'd like for her birthday. And she hoped that she would get some, nice things. So far, she hasn't hoped for a pony, but I'm sure that's coming at some point. I'm not paying for that. But that's the way that some people view. They read across this word hope, and it's more of a wish. Cross your fingers, close your eyes, and find a shooting star, and all these other things. It's like maybe it will come true, and that is one definition. The Bible's definition of what God is talking about with this idea of hope is: hey, here's the facts. There's heaven. God wants you there, and you can do it. That is a fact. And because we have that fact, now we have hope to be able to continue, because I don't know if you've noticed this or not, but the world is kind of dark and just, scary, sinful, horrible sometimes. There's some place that we can go that is the total opposite of all that. It is being prepared for us, as a matter of fact. That thought, that knowledge, that place is there, that gives us hope to be able to continue even when the world is so dark all around us. And so this idea of hoping on this fact, or the fact that we have that, the fact of heaven and God's love and the freedom from sin, that allows us to continue on, and having that as a common goal, and that makes it easier for us to be unified. Because if we were all thinking of, well, this is what I'm moving towards, and we're moving toward different directions, it's really, really hard to stay unified. It is, again, sharing a vision, sharing a goal. We're looking for the same result, that grand family reunion on the Day of Judgment as we walk in to our eternal home. And as we have this same hope, and the same instructions from God, we are working together to be able to obtain those results, to be able to grasp that realization of the hope together when time ends. And you probably have never noticed this, but maybe I've heard rumors of maybe people working and people doing working really, really hard on something, and then looking around and seeing, why am I the only one working? And the image of the government job. You have the one guy driving the shovel, and the 17 supervisors around the hole that are making sure that he is using that shovel correctly. And it's much easier if everybody is working with the same effort, with the same goal, and everybody is digging in and doing what needs to be done. If we all have that same hope, that's a lot easier to do. And you look at some of the words we used in the points up above here, common and sharing and same. Again, unity is a lot easier when we have those words being used instead of words like uncommon, selfish, and different. God wants us to be using those common, sharing, and same words when it comes to what we are doing, how we are working together, the tasks that we have, the vision that we have, the goals that we have. He wants us to be able to do that together. But again, it's not just things that we've made up. It's the things that are in the scriptures that he's given us so that we can also be unified with him. And we look at, take rowing for an example. I've been in a rowboat. And how these guys can get the boat to go in one direction in a, you know, really, really fast, I have no idea, because I can't do it by myself. And here are a bunch of people in the same boat rowing, and they can get from point A to B really, really fast. And the cool thing is they do it backwards. And they're not even looking where they're going, and they are getting there. Well, that's usually because somebody's, providing the instructions. You can see in the picture here, again, they're backwards. Well, maybe you can see in the picture. Let me tell you about the picture that's up here. Because they're, when I was getting the drone shot from Google Images, I was not able to zoom in on this. But you can see there's two sets of oars that are in the water, two sets of oars that are out of the water. And so you have to imagine here, because I didn't get the video. But, it's down and up, and, they are moving, and they are just shooting towards whichever direction that they're going. And, usually somebody is calling it out for them to be able to say, here's when we're, stroke. And, so everybody's in the same time, because if everybody had their own agenda, everybody doing it at a different speed, because I think I'm going to take this round off, it's a little bit more difficult, right? And so one slight deviation, well, now you're in somebody else's lane, and I don't think these things have airbags. So then it's a big wreck on the water. To be able to get where they're going, finding the goal, the finish line first, they have to stay together. And again, this is unity is absolutely essential in this particular sport. I mean, we're talking picking up the boat all at the same time, setting down the boat all at the same time. And I know it's not really a boat, they call it different things, but I hurt my skull when I think of what they're trying to call it. And so, but again, all of these different things, they're together, they are unified. And it's that hope of victory that unites. And so we look at this again with hope. We're going to look at three different things. We're going to look at justification, and we're going to look at salvation, and we're going to look at other things that, again, that push us toward that one hope, motivation. How do we get there? And so we look at this term justification. It means a couple of different things. Normally, if people just are using it, being justified or just justification is, here's what I'm doing, here's how I'm going, here's how I'm saying things, here's where I'm spending my money, here's where I'm spending my time, and I'm justified in doing that. I'm making the right decisions, even if everybody else is different. And so that's one way to look at justification. The other way to look at justification, biblically, being justified, freed from sin, something that only God can do. And so we're going to submerge these a little bit and talk about the idea of, as Christians, again, with the world just washing over us, saying, you are going the wrong way. Well, not according to the instructions that I'm reading, for the one that, these instructions are given from the creator of the entire universe, the one that's preparing my home in heaven. He says, this is the way I need to go. So we want to have that feeling of justification. We want to say, all right, I'm making the right decision. But at the same time, we can't do it on our own. God is the only one that can really justify us. And so we look at this. This is somebody... I've not heard a lot about him. He was a pretty big deal a few years ago. Hisham Gerouge. And listen, if I said that wrong, it'd be like if you're from Morocco or something like that and you really know how to say this name, then I apologize. Google told me how to say his name. So I'm just Hisham Garouj. All right, so this guy is, well, he's really big in the running world. So I had to look him up because I'm not in the running world, as you might can imagine. And so he's from Morocco. He actually holds 3 world records. And he's a super fast guy, 1,500, 2,000, and in the mile. He's got world records. And you can see in the chart to the right there, he's got the little G's there. That's gold medals. He's been in multiple world championships in, you know, indoor and outdoor. And mid-90s to mid-2000s. So there's about a 10-year mark there. He was the man. I mean, you get to a race and, oh, he's in it. I'm out. I mean, you know he's going to win. I mean, he was just that fast, that good. I mean, I don't know if he just didn't have anything to do over in Morocco or he just liked to run. I don't know. But he was really good at this whole running thing. Well, except for what you don't see over there, well, the Olympics. You know, you have that GOAT discussion. When you have that, the greatest of all time, who is that in whatever particular sport? A lot of times it's, okay, he's thrown for this many yards. He's run for this many yards. He's scored this many points. But a lot of times it's, how many rings does he have? How many championships has he? How many Super Bowls? How many World Series? How many NBA championships? And so when running, you can just rack up all kind of hardware. How many Olympic golds have you got? Next question, please. Because he had a little bit of trouble in the Olympics. And so 1996 was his first foray into the Olympics. Absolute favorite to win. That was right in the middle of you know, him getting started and him getting his name out there. Made it to the finals and fell. Finished last. And this is not like the video games where, you know, you just respawn and start over again. There's no do-overs. Hey, listen, my shoelaces were untied. Can we line up and try that again? I should have won. You get one shot. And better luck next time in 4 years. So he comes back again. Now we're in the middle of his heyday. The year 2000 in Sydney, absolute favorite to win. And some other guy has the audacity to be faster than him. He gets first loser. Oh, I'm sorry. He wins a silver medal, which is really good, okay? Second place, I mean, we're talking the Olympics. That's pretty good. But last time I checked, silver was not gold. So he makes it to the 2004. That was a big deal. Of course, it's in Athens. And this is his last hope to win gold because he was old. He was 30. You can't run when you're 30. Or so I've heard. Anyway, this was it. He was not expected to win because of his age disability, being so old in the running world. And he actually didn't do well in the years before that, finishing 7th and 8th. I mean, there were a whole lot of people faster than him. But he started off, made it to the finals, started off in the lead, and then some guy came up behind him and waved at him as he went by. And then he was able to kick it in, find another gear at the very end, won by 0.12 seconds. Gold medal, 1,500 meters. 4 days later, able to win the 5,000 meter as well, gold in that. And he pulled what they call a Seinfeld. I'm going out on top. He was done racing internationally after that. He may have done some stuff locally, but officially retired from the running world in 2006. He said he was justified. All of this effort, all of this time, my entire life, I was running, and so I couldn't get that gold, and so I ran more and more and more. I tried harder, and now I'm justified in what I did. That hope of Olympic gold justification kept him running. See, the problem is that, yes, he played a significant role in that. Nobody else got him up at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning so he could run. That was up to him. And train, sweat, run some more, take a shower, run some more. Nobody was making him do that. He had to decide to do that on his own. So he played a significant role in that. But also playing a role in that is the fact that somebody had to put on the Olympics. Somebody had to be slower than he was as well. And unfortunately, sometimes, again, merging together these definitions of justification and wanting to be free from sin, some try to find spiritual justification on their own. Maybe I just need to do more. Maybe I just need to work harder in this particular area. Maybe I just need to be nicer. Maybe I just need to give more. And yet we see that's the exact opposite of what we see in Matthew chapter 5. The Sermon on the Mount, we won't go through all of them. We'll pick one of the Beatitudes. And Matthew chapter 5 and verse 3, this reminder from Jesus, again, kicking it off. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The idea of, I can't do this on my own. I can want it more than anything, more than anyone. I can work harder more than anything or anyone. I can read more. I can memorize more. I can just be more. I'm going to self-improve my way to freedom from sin. It's not, again, this idea of being poor in spirit is not blessed are the poor. This poor in spirit is, God, I can't do it on my own. I need your help. And of course, he's just sitting there saying, I know. I told you. We need to realize that. To be justified, spiritually speaking, we need God. We must have his help. Again, this idea of, I'm just going to do more, goes against what Paul said in Ephesians chapter 2 in verse number 8. He says, for by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It's the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. Again, this idea of this is a gift from God. This is something we can't go out and buy. We can't work our way into. We can't barter our way into being saved. It's God's grace. It's his love for us. We don't do anything to deserve it, but we have to remember that we are to be obedient to the word of God, to the instructions that he gives us. And so, I've got the note up there, so many leave off verse number 10. Because they focus so much on by grace we've been saved. Okay. And sometimes that's as far as they go. Well, they bring in the word gift. But again, for by grace you've been saved through faith. Well, that's, it's not God's faith. Paul is talking to us. That's something that we have to have. That Hebrew writer reminds us, without faith it's impossible to please God. And so here is Paul reminding us of that as well. All right, so yes, we can be saved. It's unmerited favor. It's the grace of God. It's his love for us that saves us. But we play a part. This faith. Not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. But then verse number 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. There's something that we have to do. To be justified, we have to do the works of God, the works of God's family, the works of the church, the works of Christians. It's not sit back and collect the gift of God, unwrap it and say how beautiful it is, and now I'm just going to sit back and enjoy it. We were created. We were put into the kingdom of God for good works, and so that we would walk in the ways that he wants us to walk. And again, the way we look at this is, remember the audience that Paul was writing to. He's writing to the church in Ephesus. So the collective group, listen, hey family, remember, this is why we're here. Yes, we're saved through faith. We're justified by God. We're given, he shares his love with us. He frees us from sin for a particular reason. Now get to work. He was talking to the church, the congregation. He was writing to the individuals that make up the church, that congregation. We are reading it together as a congregation, but the church is made up of individuals. This is our instructions, collectively and also personally. We can't be justified on our own. God does that for us. There is our hope that we can be unified in this justification that we are looking for. Is that one of the things that we are striving for together? Because that makes it a whole lot easier to be unified in God's word if we have that same goal in mind. Again, a reminder to us, for us, we only have one hope of real justification. That's coming from God. Isaiah 59, verse number 2, he reminds God's chosen people. God's not short-handed. God's not weak. God is not, just unpowerful. But he's not listening. And it's your fault. Your sins have separated you from God. So we talked in class this morning, Job was saying, God's built this wall up to separate me from him for some reason. Well, if we are separated from God for any reason, it's not his. He is not the reason that we're separated. Again, he told Isaiah to let us know, we make the choice to be separated from God. Whether that's a big ditch or a wall or, well, he's just turned his ears off to us. It is our choice when we choose to sin. That separates us from God. And later we see in chapter 64, verse number 6, this is scripture, all our deeds are like polluted garment. Again, there's these righteous deeds that we do, that they can't fix anything if all we're doing is trying to good our way into a relationship with God. He's the only one that can free us from sin so that we can have that relationship with God. Romans chapter 7, verse 24, again, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself serve the law of God with my mind, with my flesh, I serve the law of sin. Again, we're wretched. We're sinful. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. God gives us a way out of that if we're willing to pursue after that one hope for our salvation. As we talked about earlier, again, it's Acts chapter 4 and verse 12, the apostles reminding us that there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Jesus is the only way we can be saved. Again, following after his instructions, following after his example, all because he died on the cross in our place. We are the ones that deserve death, and he took our place. So there's no other one. There are plenty of people that might save somebody. We have medical personnel that go out and save people's lives. We have police and fire and military. They save people's lives. Random strangers pulling people out of the street so they don't get run over. They just saved a life that will eventually end again, or end at some point. To be saved for all eternity. Well, we only have one name that can do that, one person who can do that. That's Jesus. and he has paid the price for us. Titus chapter 3, verse number 4, when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Our justification only comes through Jesus. If we want eternal life, that only comes through Jesus. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 18, on the other hand, a former commandment is set aside because of its weakness and uselessness, for the law made nothing perfect. But on the other hand, a better hope is introduced through which we draw near to God. And we've talked about the idea of Hebrews is how much better Jesus is than anything that's out there. Better than the law of Moses, better than angels, better than the old way of doing things. Jesus is the best way for us to have eternal life. Well, he's the only way. Is that our thought as a congregation, as a group of individuals that are working together? Is that idea of justification? Again, I know I can only get freedom from sin in this way. Is that our same thought, our same mission? Again, this hope for justification. We know who saves us. Well, that also, if you know, there's only one way, and that is Jesus. Does that help us encourage each other? Hey, listen, we're reading the same instruction book. We've got the same plan. We have the same marching orders. We have the same task to complete as Christians. Let's do it together. Because that, again, being on the same pathway helps us submit to the one who is going to allow us into heaven for all eternity. And if we are one in our thoughts, one in our message, one in our actions, well, then when it comes time to say, hey, why don't you come study the Bible with us? Hey, why don't you come in and visit with us, worship together with us? They see the same thing over and over again. This people has the message down. And it is very difficult to try to convince somebody that you are trying to explain to them the truth if the message being heard is something different about something as simple as, well, should we be baptized or not? Well, what are your thoughts on that? Well, my thought is, let's go to the Bible and find the answer. Instead of, well, this guy says this, this particular group of people says this, how do you feel about it? And all the other different types of answers that might be out there from people and internet and books and other sources. It is really hard to convince somebody this is the way. And so you have so many people that are just bailing out of Christianity altogether because you can make the Bible say anything that you want. And we have tried to prove that point over and over again as mankind. Well, actually, if we read through the scriptures, it lays it out for us if we will keep our thoughts and prejudices out of the way. If we are unified in our message and the actions match the message, it is much easier to fulfill the Great Commission and be able to spread the gospel and have the desired results that we want. This message of there's one hope to be justified, and that's coming from the gospel, one source. You who once were alienated, hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he is now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. And that, well, that little word there in verse number 23, if. See, he's done all this. He's put us in the body. He has cleansed us. He's freed us from sin. And then Paul then goes and messes with things and says, if. If indeed you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, of which I, Paul, became a minister. Over and over again, we read. through the scriptures. We call them the books of the Bible. Steve kind of mentioned that a little bit this morning, this letter that we call 1 Peter. Well, we have this letter that we call Colossians. This was a letter from Paul to a church, and we have these in the New Testament. They had been taught the gospel, the clean, pure, unadulterated gospel, and in a matter of pages, they decided to tweak it and make it better. Their message was not unified with the body of Christ. Again, the rest of the world, the rest of God's family. And in some places, Corinth, the message was not unified even in the congregation, because we're going to go over here, follow after him. We're going to go over here, follow after him. And as twisted as man's mind is, sometimes it was just, look at how awesome we are. We can have totally different messages all from the same congregation. Come find the group that you want to hang out with. And they celebrated it. And Paul said, stop. There is only one message. There is only one hope. There's only one name that we can be saved by. This hope for justification, we know the truth. That can unify us into making sure that we obey the truth, teach the truth, live the truth. So I mentioned we're going to talk about a couple of other things. Well, Lord willing, we'll be talking about a couple of other things tonight. We'll talk about motivation. We'll talk about salvation, again, as far as this hope that we have that unites us. But again, we talk about that there's only one way to be saved, and that is God's way, that is Jesus. And again, in our message, that is a unified message, just a reminder that we can't do things on our own. So we've got the division here with God's part and man's part. If we did this part here, And we could really, really mean it. We could go through it again, learn all there is about the Bible. We could believe in Jesus as the Son of God. We could change and follow all the instructions that are in the Scriptures and get rid of our old life. And we could confess our faith in Jesus as the Son of God and be baptized, hoping to have our sins washed away, and then keep acting like that. We could do all of that and be really awesome at it. If this part didn't happen, then we're just really nice people. It took this happening first so that we could do all of this. And, of course, we can flip that around. Well, this has already happened. God sent his Son to die on the cross. We remembered that earlier this morning with the Lord's Supper. He died. He was buried. He came back to life. And the Holy Spirit inspired writers to give us God's word so that we knew what we needed to do. All of this has happened. If this doesn't happen, we lose that hope of justification, that freedom from sin. And so we both play a part. God plays a part. Man plays a part. But they both need to happen. Yeah, God's taking care of his part. The rest is up to us. Again, when we talk about God separating himself from us, he's there. His arms are open. His ears are open. He's ready for us. Unless we decide to go against his will and sin. So maybe you've obeyed the gospel. Maybe you've gone through all of that and had sins washed away and then have left him. And God has separated himself because of our choices, our sin. Thankfully, he has given us a way back. It's asking him for forgiveness. It's changing, or repenting, turning our life back around, and being willing to follow after his will once again. It's just asking him for forgiveness so he will wash that sin away again. And we are justified. our sins are washed away. We have that hope that's out there of eternal life in heaven with him and with all those that follow after him. If there's something this morning that that we can do, we're singing this song to encourage each other to bring everything to him. We be willing to change from your broken life to the life that he wants you to live. That is our plea. But you're not on your own. If we can help, we want to. Whether that's studying together, praying together, just talking together, whatever it is that we can do, we'd love to be able to help do that. Even now as we stand and sing.
Bring Christ your broken life, so marred by sin. He will create anew, make whole again. Your empty, wasted years he will restore, and your iniquities remember no more. Bring him your every care, if great or small, whatever troubles you, oh, bring it all. Bring him the haunting fears, the nameless dread, thine heart he will relieve and lift up thy head. Blessed Savior of us all, almighty friend, his presence shall be ours unto the end. Without him life would be how dark, how drear, but with him morning breaks and heaven is near.
Thank you, Gary. Very good lesson. We get a good series of lessons that we've been able to enjoy from Ephesians. And, it's good to see everyone here this morning. Remember those announcements that were made earlier, and especially those that we need to remember in our prayers, encouragement that we might have for one another as we have opportunity.
And just for tonight, I'm going to give you some homework. Hoping everybody comes back prepared for tonight's lesson. I'm going to throw you a question, just think about it all day, and then make sure you don't have to tell me right out loud tonight. But the question, I want you to bring the answer back tonight, is what would you do for a Klondike bar? Just think about it. Come back tonight ready to answer that question. Okay? Thanks.
Here. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to come here together and worship you. We thank you for the hope that you've given us through your son's death on the cross. We ask that you be with us throughout the rest of the day and let us come back here to learn more about your word. We ask that you be with us throughout the week and help us be safe and always remember in all that we say and all that we do to put you first. We thank you again for your son's sacrifice on the cross. Which represents the forgiveness of our sins, the ability to have that, and the ability to have a home in heaven with you one day. And it's through all your son's name that we pray. Amen.